Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here this Thursday night. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also playing live in St. Paul over SPNN. And this is a live call-in talk show. So if you have any comments or questions, please feel free to call in. The number is 651-747-3838. But, and we'll see that graphic up here in a little bit. But if you don't want to call in, you can email me with your comments and suggestions or input. I greatly appreciate it. I'd eventually get back to you. It may take a year, but no promises. But I do read them once a month or so. No, you know, it's just however it happens. This is a volunteer program, volunteer people coming on, running this, and we have our lives to live. And this is part of it, though. And I appreciate those that have emailed me, the speechlessmn@gmail.com, and other people have called, and it's just amazing some of the calls you get, and I'll highlight a couple of them in this show today, but I appreciate that. There's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of hurting people, a lot of people who have been scammed by the system or trying to expose corruption or problems within our system so that we don't have justice. That's coming from the governmental people. So I'm getting calls again about false transcript, judges falsifying transcripts and being involved in the process of falsifying evidence. And I tell you, when attorneys call you and tell you that it took place, it's probably happening. Of course, I've seen it myself firsthand and other people, so it's no surprise, but what do you do about it? How do you hold the judges accountable? Also hearing stuff from federal courts about how they treat people they consider psychotic or file too many cases and are pro se, so they treat them different than if you have a lawyer helping you out. So instead of having your case heard in Minnesota, it will be sent down to one particular judge in Missouri. And you don't get an oral argument then if you don't have an attorney. But even if you have an attorney and they've deemed you to go over the edge, even with an attorney, you still don't get oral arguments. And it's down in Missouri with this one judge, which just seems terribly wrong. Can they do that? I don't know what the rules are. In Minnesota, you wouldn't be able to get away with that. It's a problem. So I appreciate the calls in. We're going to investigate these things and try to get some changes made and get this stuff out to the public and out to the lawmakers so that, you know, we can live in our freedom and have not somebody railroad us whenever they want to. Okay, so, and then past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. You can go and watch past shows there. But before I get the main topic tonight is about same-sex attraction, the various topics that are arising out of that, whether it's treatable, what are the options for treating same-sex attraction, what's going on down at the legislature, other states. My guest Kevin Peterson will be on later, and we're going to talk about that issue, which a lot of laws are being passed and things are made illegal that were normal before. So we'll get in on that discussion. But before we do that, I have about four issues that I want to talk about first, briefly. And, you know, I like to pay attention to science and to evolution or evolutionism, creationism, creation, you know, those type of things, and the debate that goes on there. And the big one that's coming out in the news today is the ancient fossils in African cave are tantalizing glimpses of early man. And I just looked at that and I'm going, okay, something's wrong here already. And National Geographic has done a big story on this. This article, oh, I forgot where this article, USA Today had an article on it. A number of them have. But I really love these scientific statements that come out. Okay, listen for the qualifiers. The fossil age is unknown, but they could be more than 2.5 million years old, or they could be relatively recent in the grand scheme of things. Homo sapiens emerged in Africa roughly 200,000 years ago, so the bones are at least that old. All right, does that sound like science to you? You know, roughly 200,000 years ago, so the bones are at least that old because we came out of Africa at least 200,000 years ago. All right, that's not science. What's more, the bodies may have been deliberately placed in the cave, suggesting that long ago human relatives were engaging in ritual disposals of their dead. Well, here's what's going to happen. If you see a picture of these guys, just change their hairstyle, give them a haircut, give them a shave, put them on the street. You know, they look like a human. And they say there's about 18 people in this cave, bones of 18 people. So how do they know they got them matched up right? They haven't discovered all that. And then the one thing I just saw on the news before I came in is that they were discussing that they're on display for a month, and that these bones are so valuable that they can only do for a month at a certain location because of the risk of losing the bones. That, to me, the one that's not scientific, those bones will be given out to people to do testing on. That's what should happen. And then what we're going to find out is things are not as they seem to be. Same with every other animal in that evolutionary scale that you are shown. All of them, except for the monkey and the human and the neanderthal, have proved to be false and falsified. And so now they have to make them more and more like humans. This is all about money and grant money. That's how I see it. Anyway, more to come on that later. We'll see how that plays out. And I'm just going by the statistics. Something's being falsified. Something's being played here to get money. Okay, we've been talking a lot about the refugee situation in St. Cloud and other places where through the United Nations and Catholic Charities, Lutheran Social Services, and other religious organizations or private secular organizations, refugees, Shiites and Sunnis, are being brought into cities, certain cities en masse, and overwhelming the social service system there in the financial system of the school districts, welfare, and other areas, and causing a lot of turmoil there from this refugee situation. And a situation came in Maine where a man was killed, stabbed to death by three Somali refugees. And there's a lot of things that aren't being said by the police officers. My whole point in this, okay, you know, it doesn't matter if somebody's a refugee or not. People are going to go kill people. Shouldn't happen. But in the situation dealing with refugees from a Shiite, Sunni-type nation, they're for a theocracy. They don't want to be here except to get the money, and they're going to cause problems. They don't believe in our Constitution, and so we're inviting our own enemy to come in. And even though these people may never, that killed this man in Maine, may never be classified as terrorists, they were doing it for terroristic reasons, and that much is known in this situation. This is a Christian man, and he was in his home reading his Bible and stabbed to death. And so, tough deal. But I also want to tie it into how the news presents this information, is because if you listen to the refugee situation that's happening in Greece, and they're coming to the island of Lesbos, and they're just flooding that island. There's about 85,000 people that live on that island, 25,000 refugees. The refugees are coming in, and when they land on the island, they destroy their boats so they can't be shipped out. And then what they're doing is they're getting in fights with the citizens of that island. And it's in a warlike situation on that island. And even in Hungary, where the refugees are going in, and they're trying to escape the war, many of these are the terrorists. Many of these people are terrorists, and their goal is to get into these other countries and upset those countries and expand their terrorism. And so they're not trying to get away from a war situation. If they're facing such hardship here and demanding money and food and clothing, and they're from a Shiite or a Sunni nation, why aren't they going to another Shiite or Sunni nation and going with their own religion and getting help from them? The point is to expand the terrorism, and they see an opportunity to get out of Syria, get out of other places to expand their terrorism. So if, you know, they should stay in their area or seek refugee in their own countries, because these countries like Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Libya, whatever, are they taking in the refugees? And if the answer is no, and that's what I believe it is, that tells you a whole lot. Why are they going to Europe rather than to where their own countries are? This is a planned thing, and we need to wake up on it. And here in the United States, the UN, which is controlled a large part by Muslim countries, is shipping their people to the United States. For what purpose? Why don't they take them? Why don't they get our money? I mean, they're getting $90 million just in Minnesota alone to take care of these people. It's trouble, and it's trouble for us, and it's not a smart thing to do. I want to do some brief comments on Kim Davis, who's running, who's the Kentucky county clerk. And I just think it's fascinating, the narrative that's going on. And we're not going to go through the whole thing here of the law and everything. But when they say she's breaking the law, what law has she broken? What law is written down that she has broken? And the answer is there is none. She has not broken down any written law. Under our Constitution, the states have jurisdiction over marriage. The federal government doesn't. Kentucky has its laws. She's abiding by Kentucky law. When the U.S. Supreme Court canceled Kentucky law, they did not write a new law for Kentucky. They just canceled Kentucky laws, so therefore there is no marriage license to give or to hand out. Federal courts have not established what the Kentucky law is. Kentucky has to do that. There is none, so we're not handing out any marriage licenses. And if Kentucky wants to have her hand out a marriage license, they need to write the law that says who she can give a marriage license to, and they haven't done that. So that's why she's asked for, write a law that gives me an exemption so that I don't have to do for what marriage license I do and or don't have to do. And then if you are going to do gay marriage licenses, then write a law that exempts me from that based on my religious beliefs, because I get to practice my religious beliefs. And that's what's going on. That's what's not being talked about, even in Fox News. The lawyers are trying to get that word out, but it's not being received, and then the press is not playing out that story. But that's how I understand the law, and that's how I receive it in this situation. Okay, judicial accountability. It happens once in a while. Sometimes a judge is held accountable. Sometimes it's not always for the reason that you may think it is. The reason may be, say it's one thing, but it's really another reason. Who knows? But in this case, just to let you know, There was a judge that lost his license, was removed from office in Mississippi, and it was Chancery Court Judge Joe Del Walker. Now, that Chancery Court would be like our district court judge here in Minnesota, and he was under the 13th Chancery Court Division, the second seat, and he was convicted in federal court. He pleaded guilty, serving 5 months in federal court prison for witness tampering. He asked a witness to destroy documents, and he also lied to FBI agents. And what happened is Judge Walker appointed a guardian for an estate of an individual, a person with disabilities. And the guardian then, under Judge Walker, was to go out and get bids. And so Judge Walker then had to review the bids to build a house for the disabled person under guardianship. And the judge noticed that his nephew had the lowest bid, but his bid was low by a whole bunch of money. So Judge Walker told his nephew, resubmit the bid and add another, resubmit the bid and add more money. And so the nephew resubmitted the bid, still ended up being the lowest bid. But Judge Walker, being an ethical man that he was, referred the case then to another judge to decide who would get the bid. Well, guess who got the bid? The lowest bid. So Judge Walker's nephew got the bid. And then somebody figured out what was going on, filed a complaint, and this all the deceiving and lying and witness tampering took place. And he got caught in federal court. He was, while the investigation was going on in state court, he was suspended with pay. Finally, when he admitted to guilt, then the Mississippi Supreme Court kicked him out of office, even though he had already resigned. Oh, what a process. Well, it's just good and refreshing to hear that judges in some places are being held accountable and actual investigations have been done. I wish that would happen in Minnesota, because there's been enough and plenty of cases where it has needed to happen, but the powers that be have this sense of judicial immunity that they can do, judges can do whatever they want and have no recourse, even if they flagrantly abuse, misuse, very aggressive against a client when they don't need to be, or a plaintiff or a respondent when they don't need to be. And that needs to be taken care of, and that's something I'm going to work on with this show, exposing some of that in the near future, and trying to get some legislation passed that these judges wouldn't be protected and get good wording in our legislature. We're the people. We make the laws, not the courts. The court makes a law. We don't like it. We overturn it. That's how it works. And we need to hold our judges accountable. So that was just good to hear. Well, okay. A lot of news has been out there about same-sex attraction and various laws going on as to, is counseling people with same-sex attraction, is it ethical? Is it moral? Is it legal? Are there dubious practices going on? Is there deception, whatever? And actually, laws have been written against counseling, and some laws are being written for counseling. And so I invited Kevin Peterson to come on the show tonight. Thank you for coming on, Kevin. You have quite a bit of history and knowledge in this area, and I'm going to pick your brain a little bit and figure out what's going on here, because this is a big deal. I mean, this is making national news, and we want to go a little bit more in depth. So why don't you give a little bit of background as to why you know so much?
Well, thank you for having me on. Thank you for not having me on right after your story about Neanderthals.
I debated, but better judgment.
But better segue. And now, yeah. Speaking of Neanderthals,
yeah.
because it does seem like a long time ago, but back in the 80s and 90s, I was very active in the gay lifestyle, and I'm in my 50s now. And
yeah. 80s was a long time ago.
It was a very long time ago. Long before cell phones and computers. Mm. So I've been there, done that.
How did we live?
We didn't. We barely got out of it.
All right.
We had a lot of experience with my friends and I with the whole gay pride thing, and every June we got involved in the pride parade, and I even marched in one in New York and was very active in it. And gay activist. Mm-hmm. And I regret some of the things I've done. And with the help of an ex-gay ministry, I found out that I didn't have to live in that gay lifestyle. I could still have same-sex attractions, but I could deal with it and live a chaste life, mm-hmm. and so on. But from them, I learned about change therapy, that it did exist for some.
So you're drawing a distinction between an ex-gay ministry and change therapy?
Yes. There's a very big difference. Too many people think of them as one big group, one big organization. The gay activists want us to think of them all as one big thing. They refer to it as conversion therapy, to give it a religious connotation. Even the president has referred to it as conversion therapy, and that's...
Is there a conversion therapy? Is there such a thing? Or is it just a nuance that other people want to make?
That is a title given to it by its opponents.
Okay.
Now, I wanted people to understand the difference between those different areas. All people with same-sex attraction, SSA, are people who have different viewpoints of it.
Okay.
Most people with same-sex attraction don't like it and want it to go away and wished it were different. And they have different ways of dealing with it.
Mm-hmm.
And some people with same-sex attraction live a gay lifestyle and they're happy with their lives, and that's pretty much their business. They're mm-hmm. they're happy and they stay there. And like I said, that's what makes them happy and makes them gay. And nobody's telling them that the best thing for them is change therapy.
Hmm.
There's this old urban legend of shock therapy. If you tie somebody into a chair and you show them pornographic pictures of someone of the same sex and you shock them or something.
Sounds like abuse.
It is. It's very, very abusive, and it never happened, and it doesn't have any value. First of all, It doesn't work. And change therapy is counseling by licensed therapists.
So it's a different approach in some regard. It may have the same outcome, but before we get into real details of that,
mm-hmm.
what got you to the place to, the statement's made, you're born gay,
mm-hmm.
so what got you to the place to think of going to an ex-gay ministry? If you knew, mm-hmm. because of your activity, this is how you were and are, and so what got you thinking about an alternative?
Because I wasn't gay. I wasn't happy in the lifestyle. I wanted to be, and I gave it a try for about 20 years. And there were times when I thought it really was for me, and this is the way I wanted to live. And it just wasn't working out. I I wasn't happy. Mm-hmm. And I saw others who also were not happy. And then I heard about people who didn't change their sexual attractions. They still had sexual attractions for people of the same sex. But they left the lifestyle. They completely got out of the lifestyle. They live a chaste life. And I met them through these ex-gay ministries. These were religious groups that serve a good purpose. And it was from them I learned about change therapy with Dr. Joseph Nicolosi, and found out that this thing, that these attractions didn't have to remain. I found out what caused them in the first place, and that was intriguing. When I listened to Dr. Nicolosi, I was surprised. It was as if he was following me around when I was a little kid, because I thought, how did he know that? How did he know about these things and these events? It was eye-opening. And so I researched it, got some help, got some counseling, and recognized what caused these attractions for me. And they went away. Not overnight, no.
No.
I have this image of this big aircraft carrier having to turn around really, really fast, and well, it's not going to happen. It takes time to slowly move it. And it did take time and patience and falling back into old habits was almost standard. It was predictable. And for me, it was something I wanted to do. I still have friends who are in these ex-gay ministries, and they're good friends of mine. I even know people who are still in the gay lifestyle. And they're friends. They know who I am. They understand it, and they're fine with it. And I'm, you know, I understand what they're doing. And they are happy. Change therapy is for people with unwanted same-sex attraction.
Okay.
It's a very big difference. It wouldn't work for people who wants to have same-sex attraction and is happy in their lifestyle. Change therapy wouldn't work, for one thing.
Well, and that is the common, that is the, well, yeah, obviously it wouldn't work, but that's the common, isn't that the common complaint about change therapy is because of the perception that people really don't want to change and you're forcing them to change?
Yes.
That's
a good point.
And so they don't believe that a person would be unhappy in that lifestyle and really wants to change. They don't believe it.
No, and they also do not want people to think that they are living in a gay lifestyle by choice. That goes against everything they have been fighting for years.
They have to.
I have to live this way. This is the way I was born.
Okay.
It's in the DNA or something. And
but it's not.
clearly no, because there are people, many people, both men and women, who have left that gay lifestyle and have gone through therapy, change therapy. I would like to point out with that wonderful pie chart of mine, if I may.
Do you want to bring that up? You want that pie chart now?
Yes. I'm not a pie chart person until I actually figured that, until I saw that.
And so I learned how to do that? Okay.
Speaking of pie chart.
There it is.
This illustrates the differences in the different groups. This circle there in the middle is SSA, or same-sex attraction. The top left is gay pride, and these are people who are happy with the gay lifestyle, and they want the activists there. Myself, I was one of them for 20 years. Want everyone to know that same-sex attraction is gay, and that everyone is gay and they are in this lifestyle and they were born this way. They can't help it. It's about time you take pride in it and not be ashamed of it. You should be proud of it. And there are those with same-sex attraction who seek out their minister. They are adults. They go to their priest or their minister, and they say, "I've got these attractions, and I think it's wrong. I need some counseling for it." Mm-hmm. And they do that, and there are groups, the many groups, and they serve a purpose, and all the power to them. Mm-hmm. Change therapy is specifically therapists who are licensed by the state, who are licensed therapists and counselors, who practiced sexual orientation change effort, SOCE, sexual orientation change effort. It's not 100% successful, but it's counseling to find the source of that attraction.
Okay.
And when they learn
it's a specific process too.
Yes.
It's kind of delineated in some books and which has been peer reviewed and
in many and it's been successful for many years, for many decades, and it is practiced by some of the best qualified, because not only are they licensed therapists, but they themselves had those attractions, and they've been through it, been there, done that. They understand what it is. They understand what those feelings are caused by.
Right.
One example is David Pickup, who himself was abused when he was a child and had these attractions as an adult and sought counseling and decided to become a trained therapist in this field. That's what change therapy is. This whole area of ex-gay ministries is separate. It is not change therapy. The ex-gay ministers are qualified for their particular church to work with people and to pray and help them lead a chaste life, but not to get rid of their same-sex attractions. They don't try to. They don't show any interest in it. They also don't have any expertise. They don't. They don't want to. They don't try to. The term "pray the gay away" was coined by one of these ex-gay ministers.
Wow.
This minister was referring to the gay lifestyle. What the activists up there in gay pride did is they took that phrase to mean that it meant to take away your same-sex attractions. And that's not what this minister meant at all.
Okay. No,
all she, it was is to get away from the gay lifestyle and the acting out and the obligation to go to pride events and so on. And then the activists, the gay activists, then took that pray the gay away and called it conversion therapy. And they've lumped change therapy and ex-gay ministers all into one big group, that it's somehow some kind of big religious conversion. Even the president has used the term conversion therapy, and I'm opposed to that, he said. The difference is, again, therapy conducted by licensed therapists and ministers. And what they have done in several states is to actually outlaw and criminalize change therapy. They did so in New Jersey with the help of Governor Chris Christie, and now the governor of Illinois has signed a similar ban. Jerry Brown signed a ban in California. Criminalizing this activity, starting out with minors, but it's going to expand to adults.
So, if I understand you, I'm sure I do. they basically outlawed somebody who says they're gay and doesn't like that feeling or that emotion or that behavior that they're engaged in. They don't like it. They've outlawed them from getting help.
Yes. They outlawed them for minors. That's how it starts.
Oh, for minors.
Using this as an example, if parents bring their child in, who is 14, let's mm-hmm. say, and brings this 14-year-old to the local minister, to their parish priest, and says, he has this problem, we need to deal with it. And he says, well, I will pray with you and help counsel you on how to live this way and according to your Christian upbringing and so on. But he finds out, the minister finds out that that 14-year-old was abused somehow mm-hmm. at the age of 7 or 8, mm-hmm. which is the cause of these same-sex attractions. A minister, mm-hmm. knowing he's not trained in that kind of trauma, mm-hmm. would say, well, you know, I happen to have somebody who you should talk to, and can mm-hmm. refer that the parents and that 14-year-old to a licensed therapist who mm-hmm. is consistent with their teachings uh-huh. and their beliefs.
Right.
In a place like New Jersey, that's against the law. They only mm-hmm. have one option, and that is to send that child up here to a gay-affirming counselor mm-hmm. up there in Gay Pride. Mm-hmm. If they decide, the parents that is, to cross over into New York, mm-hmm. that child could be taken away from them and put into foster care.
So you raise a whole nother issue there then of a parent's authority, a parent's right to raise their children in the education or upbringing that they choose. So that goes away. You also, the child then is left in a stressful situation for themselves, mm-hmm. a situation that they don't know how to cope with, except they can only get one form of counseling.
Yes.
So you're potentially criminalizing a parent, the therapist, a whole bunch of people for help that people want.
And for what benefit?
Yeah. Well, has there been complaints about this therapy or people being abused in the therapy, or why? What is the reason that these legislators have and governors have passed these laws?
They hold hearings in their various state legislatures,
right.
and they bring people forward who have these horror stories of shock therapy and being abused by counselors and ministers who say that you're going to go to hell if you don't change your ways, and it's abuse, and it's emotional abuse, and it's traumatizing. And I even went to a camp, and this camp was an evangelical camp, and it was abusing me, and it was horrible. None of those stories were true. They were all made up. They were all fabricated. And
well, they say
there
that,
are
I mean,
no charges against any licensed therapist in change therapy. There have never been any accusations of wrongdoing.
But even on the minister's end, that's the message anyway to every person that goes to a Bible camp or a church. You're a sinner. You're a liar. You know, you've broken one of the Ten Commandments. So whether you're gay or not, you know, by the Bible, you're going to hell unless you repent. It has nothing to do with being gay anyway.
But in that case, that is specifically the beliefs of different organizations or different churches and denominations and the ex-gay ministries, as I said. That's mm-hmm. that is really something I don't know anything about. Mm-hmm. And those stories were specifically about change therapy. Mm-hmm. And that was the target,
okay.
not ex-gay ministries. They were targeting change therapy,
okay.
and that's why they had to make up stories of abuse. Because
about ex-ministers?
No, they made up stories.
The
they made stories up about change therapists.
Okay.
And again, there are no accusations against these therapists, mm-hmm. and they've been around a long time.
Yeah. Wow.
And they pass these laws somehow to protect the patient. There already is a law in every single state in the union to protect patients from abuse from a counselor. Parents or the child can actually bring a formal complaint to the state licensing board and have that license removed from that counselor.
If there's been abuse.
If those stories are half true,
right.
Those counselors would be in serious trouble.
Yeah,
with the licensing board, there's no need to pass a new law somehow.
Well, where is this, where is Minnesota with these laws and this whole concept?
A year ago.
Can they do change therapy? Can AFC?
Oh, yes.
X-Gay Ministries?
It is currently legal in Minnesota.
Okay.
The attempts to criminalize it started a year ago in 2014, but they were defeated. There were Republicans and Democrats alike who all agreed that there's no reason to ban this therapy. I spoke to some of them and some of my own representatives too, and they're Democrats, like I said, and Republicans who don't see a need to criminalize change therapy. And
but there was an attempt.
An attempt last year and an attempt this year.
2015.
Yes.
Okay.
The bills were introduced in both the House and Senate.
Did they get any hearings?
No.
In
neither last year or this year, but they're coming back.
Okay.
They're not going to give up.
It's not likely that the House would give a hearing, or?
I don't know.
But it's more likely that the Senate would.
No, because it's a bipartisan issue.
Okay.
Both the support for change therapy and the opposition to change therapy.
That comes from both
parties.
Both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it really depends on the chair of a particular committee. Yeah, I mean, I think, did you feel, well, I don't know, there's you or did the therapist feel threatened enough to do something about it? I mean.
Yes, the that's why we just wanted to convince people, and both liberals and conservatives, like I said, it's a bipartisan issue all around. And I wanted to reach out to people and inform them that change therapy works.
Mm-hmm.
Not on everybody. Not everybody wants it.
Yeah.
It's just for those who want to have a counselor work out their issues and let them.
Yeah.
Nobody's forcing everybody to do it.
What, according to change therapy, what are some of the issues? You mentioned one as far as abuse, some type of sexual abuse or just abuse in general, as to why somebody has same-sex attractions, or one of the reasons. Are there other reasons?
Well, a lot of trauma and not being close to a father, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
I heard of one case where this man was very close to his father, loved his father very much, but he just did not, it just didn't work out because his father was always ill and was very weak, and his mother had to run the household, and it's not the father's fault.
Mm-hmm.
And he found out that everyone has different different cases. I don't know most of them because, again, I'm not the counselor.
Right. Yeah.
And these vary from person to person.
Do you see people that are just confused about their sexuality? They don't know, you know, whether they're male or female, or you know, they just somehow they've gotten messages.
Yes, that kind of confusion has been around, according to your study, probably 4 million years. for centuries, these people have had these attractions. It wasn't until the 19th century. Mm-hmm. When a Hungarian journalist invented the name homosexual and gave it a scientific sound to it, that there is heterosexual and homosexual. And then people who were teenagers and having these attractions realized, uh-oh, I have this condition known as. Mm-hmm. Very scientific. And I always thought that it was some kind of brain wiring neurologic thing going on in my head that of which I had no control. Mm-hmm. And these things, you know, they just happened, and I guess I'm a homosexual. Okay. Therefore, I am gay.
Okay.
And so I live the lifestyle I'm supposed to live. It's very frustrating, of course. Hmm. Very, very frustrating. Only because the message given to people is that these attractions are just that. It's mm-hmm. clinical and it's hardwiring. That's where the confusion comes in. That's why people by the thousands are confused about their sexuality. Mm-hmm. And this whole Bruce Jenner thing is very confusing because now elementary schools are teaching that there's no such thing as gender. You shouldn't right. have little girls dressed like little girls, and you shouldn't have little boys dressed like little boys, and they shouldn't have their own restrooms. Well, this is going to really upset Bruce Jenner. He thinks there's such a thing as gender.
Yeah.
He thinks girls should dress like girls and boys should dress like boys. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want to dress like a boy anymore. He wants to dress like a girl.
Because he thinks he's a girl.
Why is Bruce Jenner the only one allowed to dress like a girl, and girls can't in mm-hmm. elementary school?
Hmm.
Don't get me started.
Yeah.
It's that kind of confusion that makes everybody confused. Of course there's confusion.
Mm-hmm.
Because, gee whiz, I wonder if maybe...
Well, and if the message from the state... If the message from society is mm-hmm. it's okay to be confused, you're really not. Well, just take some time to pick one. No, you really are what you think you are, or you feel you are. That's just going to add to it. That's not going to mm-hmm. make a person question, you know, even though everything about me says I'm male. Every single cell chromosome in my body says I'm a male, or every cell chromosome says I'm a female. Mm-hmm. And I, because my brain and my thinking says I'm opposite, then my brain wins.
If an adult decides that he is gay and wants to live the lifestyle, that's his business.
Mm-hmm.
If someone, either as the parents of a teenager or even as an adult, decides, you know, I want to talk to somebody about this and find out what really causes this,
right.
fine, let him do it.
Right.
It's a freedom of speech issue.
Mm-hmm.
It's a freedom of religion issue. It's a freedom of conscience.
Association.
And everything. And it is freedom of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to educate people. I want people to get the message that change therapy works.
Mm-hmm.
And again, not for everybody.
Right. Yeah, so let those who want the freedom to change
mm-hmm.
or feel better about what they're doing, let them get that therapy.
Mm-hmm.
And go with that, other than what it's being touted as, we're going to force you to change and you have to change, and mm-hmm. that's not even on the radar screen.
The only forcing and bullying is coming from the state of New Jersey and now Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the forcing comes in,
mm-hmm.
and forcing parents to accept what they say is the inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes against all of the liberties we take for granted here in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't have them in California anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And again, that's why I put together this campaign to inform people that it works.
Yeah. Well, that's important to know, and because there is a vicious side that seems to be out there that's really not out there, and it's more promoted that this is an aggressive attack, a hateful thing, mm-hmm. and it's not. It's not. It has nothing to do with hate at all. Mm-hmm. So what are your you guys have done some advertising, some billboards, mm-hmm. and I think we got one up here. But this mm-hmm. is not in Minnesota here.
Yes, that's the billboard for a particular website, and that is for David Pickup,
okay.
a licensed therapist. Okay. And this is a photograph of his billboard in Dallas.
Okay, and I'm going to get a different close-up. So
okay. And we just, for 3 months, put it up at in Elk River.
Okay. This very same one, or
yes.
a mm-hmm. little bit different?
A little bit different. If you not do your same-sex attractions mean you are gay? Is the top line we had on the billboard.
This one's not showing up.
But okay. it... reparative therapy. There it is.
Yeah.
That works. And this reparativetherapycenter.com is David Pickup's website. And it's very informative because he explains, mm-hmm. Gives a lot of detail, better than I can, about different causes and how some people have come to him and some of his patients are gay. And they come to him for other reasons, whatever uh-huh. it is, you know, smoking or drinking, whatever,
okay.
whatever their problem is. And he's not trying to change them. He just works with them with other issues.
For what they want to do. So
mm-hmm.
if they want to quit smoking
mm-hmm.
or drinking, he helps them do that. So if they want to quit the gay lifestyle, mm-hmm. they help them.
He can help them with that,
quit
too.
That.
And they know who he is, and they respect him for it, and mm-hmm. they have no intention of changing their same-sex attractions. They're happy with their mm-hmm. lifestyle, and he says, "Oh, fine with them, fine with me," he said. And he's been a positive influence for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
David Pickup, and that's why we posted his billboard
okay.
For 3 months.
So where does somebody... here in Minnesota, where do they go? I know we have this Facebook page here, Change Therapy Works.
Mm-hmm.
So somebody can, you know, go on Facebook and find that page. But are there other places here that you know of that?
Yes, and they can contact me personally.
Okay.
And
how are they going to get a hold of you?
Well, they could go to my website, which is godsrecruit.com.
Okay. All right. Godsrecruit.com. Let's put that up, if that's okay.
Oh, you can do that too?
Yeah.
You're amazing. You're more advanced than some of those Neanderthals.
Yeah, well, you're not the first one to call me amazing either. So. No, you probably are.
At least not on air.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And thank you for the chance to get the message out.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you coming on. So we're going to expect it again this year in the legislature. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the main thing is calling it for what it is versus what it isn't. And that's kind of the game in everything, mm-hmm. down at the legislature to deceive people, in a sense. But not everybody's trying to do that.
Mm-mm.
And this is an important parental right issue. And it's important to help kids. And I've seen it down at the St. Paul School Board, where kids go to the school board and they say, I'm confused. So get me to where I need to be. I'm a boy, but I feel like a girl, so I feel I need to go to the girls' restroom. And they're telling the school board this.
Mm-hmm.
And the school board is just basically saying, whatever you feel, we're going to accommodate. And
I should also mention that all of these laws that ban change therapy
uh-huh.
are very, very careful that they put in wording that says the kind of therapy they do not want banned, that this ban does not include a mom and a dad bringing their 9-year-old boy in for hormone shots because they want him to have a sex change operation.
So the parents could push that issue.
Oh, the parents could do it, they could bring in the hormone shots and have doctors surgically alter the boy into a little girl, and which does happen. It's
right.
It's happened in Boston and in Denver
mm-hmm.
With these parents who want to alter their children. That kind of change therapy, the gay activists want to protect.
They support.
So that wording is always in those change therapy bans. They said, well, this does not include.
Wow. Well, that's a big deal. Well, we're out of time. I want to thank you for coming on, Kevin, and appreciate your insights. Well, folks, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. We'll see you next week with another very informative show. Good night.
Takes the kite as the firefly brings the light. You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. The days go by, the forest sets on fire.